So what is the concept of polarity? Why does it matter? Polarity is one of the keys that unlocks understanding human behavior, understanding yourself, and understanding others. It's also one of the keys to changing, modifying, and improving your own behavior. Interestingly enough, polarity can explain how human compatibility, attraction, and interaction can work. This could be in terms of romance or camaraderie, siblings, friends, coworkers, acquaintances, even your relationship to yourself. So what are some of the larger implications of this concept of polarity? Today, we're covering the basics of polarity. What is it? How does it work? And how can I use it? Before we get started, please give this channel a subscribe if you would like more free videos on personal development, intentional living, and creativity. Be sure and click the bell icon so that you get notified every time I post a new video. All right, so first of all, what is this concept of polarity? Polarity is like a framework of looking at things. It's like a different perspective. In short, polarity says that there sometimes is this illusion of two separate things that are opposites. And in reality, these two things could be two extreme degrees of one singular thing. There are entire belief systems around this that say that this applies to everything. This is nothing that I was brought up with. It's something that I've stumbled upon recently. And actually, like, it makes my head kind of hurt to think about this, whether it's true or not, that this could apply to everything. From my perspective, I'm just gonna take this concept and apply it to where I think makes sense. And what makes the most sense to me is I can admit there are at least some cases where this explanation of polarity definitely applies. Some very simplified examples, like hot and cold, seem like two separate opposites of each other. But in reality, they are on the continuum of temperature, and they're just two extreme degrees of the same thing. Same with loud and quiet. They are just two different aspects of volume. Let's dig a little bit deeper into these overly simplified examples just for the sake of understanding and look at some qualities of this concept of polarity. All right, so you have one singular continuum with two opposing or opposite extremes. When you think about it, one would not really make sense without the other. How would we know what hot was if everything was cold? How would we know what loud was if everything was soft? So there's this concept of like contrast, like one kind of defines the other and vice versa. There's also like this weird fuzziness in the middle. For example, it would be very hard to get consensus from people on the continuum of sound volume. Like, where does it stop being loud and start being soft? You would ask 100 different people, could give you 100 different answers to that question. The judgment on that continuum of sound volume would be filtered through our own preferences, our own point of views. So yeah, there's like a fuzziness in the middle. Also, one polarity cannot exist without the other. You cannot have loud without soft. It wouldn't even make sense. If you can't have one without the other, there are several implications. And one of those implications is, okay, you have to have acceptance of what already is. You can't judge loud and say loud is bad and soft is good because they don't exist without each other. So that introduces kind of this idea of like transcendence, where you accept the whole thing, the whole continuum, and you find a way to bring it into balance and kind of see past any illusion of duality. Am I making sense? All right, so how the heck does this apply to human behavior? Well, we know that with polarity, where one polarized degree exists, there must be another. They don't exist in a vacuum. They are all parts of one continuum. It would become very helpful for you to start gaining awareness in areas where you are extremely polarized. Why? Because if we're polarized in one direction, we know that the opposite must exist somewhere within our being. If we deny, suppress, or reject that part of ourself, it gets pushed down into our subconscious. This likely happens because, based on psychological theory, our personality, the part, our ego, the part of us that people would say is our personality, the part of us that interacts with the world, the part of us that identifies with traits, those traits are the things that we have deemed to be useful, helpful, valuable, where we draw our value, things that we deny, suppress, or reject are things that we push away from ourselves. When we have things that we reject within our being, we know that there will come a time where you will get triggered. It is for this reason that working with my own subconscious in a variety of ways has become hugely important to me. I could do an entire video on that, and maybe I will, but for now, just rest assured that I myself take very specific steps to uncover what is in my own subconscious. Why? Because whatever we push down, suppress, deny, reject about ourselves, whatever qualities we push away from our personality, those things have a high likelihood of getting triggered. I don't know how aware you are of triggers. Maybe you've been to see a therapist, or maybe you've just read up on this, but triggers are when something exists within us and an external event happens to bring up that old stuff, those old beliefs, those old traumas, whatever lies within that we haven't dealt with yet. For example, someone watching this video could be like, "You're dumb and ugly." And if I had a belief inside myself that was like, "Am I dumb and ugly?" and someone said that to me, that would trigger me. I would get really upset and be, you know, probably lash out at the person. In reality, what's happening is I'm wondering, you know, are they right? If I have the belief that I am smart, capable, and a beautiful human being, then someone says I'm dumb and ugly, I'm just like, okay, well, you're entitled to your opinion then. Do you see from that simplified example how what's inside of you can get triggered? I have the personal belief that this is by design from our Creator, that we have these triggers, that they are a gift and an invitation to notice when we get triggered, that that is an opportunity for us to take a step back. Triggers are an invitation for us to go internal, examine our own conceptions of self, where we draw our value, what are our beliefs, and when we get triggered, that's an invitation to kind of re-examine some of that stuff and see if something needs to be shifted. Triggers are a gift because they help us become aware of things that we were not aware of. They help the unconscious become conscious. Consciousness itself is a continuum. You have your consciousness and your unconsciousness, and that those themselves are polarities that we want to work to balance. Again, if you go back to the qualities of poles, of polarity, we know that the opposite extreme will always exist somewhere. So if we deny, suppress, and reject our opposite poles, then they will come out. It will just be chaotically. It'll come out when we're stressed, when we get pushed. However, if you bring these things into your awareness, they can come out in a much more healthy fashion, and we can become more aware. We can increase our awareness and work to integrate these parts of ourselves and achieve balance. Awareness alone can lower our likelihood of getting triggered. Just knowing that something exists inside of us, we can have that awareness, and when things come up, maybe the trigger comes up in your emotions, but you don't act on it. I know this sounds very abstract. I actually did another video on my other channel that talks about kind of the continuum of relationship with food. And the poles to that would be, on this one side, you have this very rigid, controlled, maybe restrictive behavior around food. Like, it takes a lot of mental energy, a lot of focus, a lot of rigidity. And then you have this other side, this other polarity, where maybe you feel out of control around food. You just can't stop eating. You just can't keep certain foods in the house. Those are two sides of the same coin, and that is a relationship to food. And when you get triggered on this end and you start feeling out of control around food, that's an invitation to do the internal work to start to work towards balance in your relationship with food. If you're interested in that specific example, I will link that video here. There are implications to understanding MBTI, Myers-Briggs as well. Myers-Briggs actually deals a lot in polarities. And I love how in MBTI, the concept of cognitive functions gives us, it starts to give us some concrete directionality in the way of discovering and working with our own polarities. Stay tuned for a future video explaining this in great detail. But for now, just suffice it to say that Myers-Briggs gives us a more concrete framework in working with this abstract concept of polarity. For example, sensing and intuition are on two separate poles of each other, but they are actually part of the same singular continuum of perceiving, how we perceive the world. You have your five senses on the one hand, and then you have kind of like the sixth sense, this gut feeling. Everybody uses both. One doesn't really exist without the other. If you happen to know that you are very polarized between those two things, that awareness alone can give huge insights into your own self-understanding and your own self-growth. So yes, polarity is a very important concept to understand when diving into personality science and understanding of self. Test it out. One way to do this is to red flag any what I call emphatic traits. That is when you are like super gung-ho about something. And that can be anything. Maybe it's being good. Maybe it's being a good person. When you start to notice those emphatic traits within yourself, just ask the question, what might the polar opposite of this be? And how might they be one singular thing? And can I name the continuum? Like, what is the one thing that these are opposite poles of? So yeah, test it out, ask questions. Maybe even just consider, like, how might this thing be a polarity and not two separate things? And ask yourself, if these two things were part of the singular continuum, what would the name of the continuum be? All right, that wraps up the video. If you learned something or got some new things to think about, give this video a thumbs up. Subscribe to my channel for more free videos on personal development, intentional living, and creativity. I would love to hear a comment and let me know if you had any ahas during this video, maybe some realization, or have you already worked with polarity? Can you think of other examples? I would love to hear from you. Leave me a comment, let me know. Thank you so much for being here, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.